You're listening to Bedroom Beethovens, where notable music makers break down stories accompanied by songs and melodies documenting growth through their 10,000-hour journey. And me? Well, my name is Cello, your host.
What's up? This is J-Rock, and I'm right here. I'm chilling on the Bedroom Beethovens podcast. That's what it is. Let's go.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Bedroom Beethovens podcast, episode number 170. Discover some of the preeminent music producers and entertainers of our time, and I turn them into storytellers. My guest this week is...
My name is Focus. I'm a music producer. I've been in the game for about over 30 years. Five-time Grammy Award winner. I've been working with Aftermath for some years now, and some of the notable records that they would know me for. I did You Already Know for 112, Where I'm From for Game. I did a song called Yes for Beyonce, and I've had the chance and the honor of working with a lot of people, a lot of known artists.
I done seen young bucks scuff Air Force Ones in Cashville, where Compton is.
Where I'm from.
Where it's just me, my son, and my bitch. She graduated when Notorious B.I.G. dropped me and my bitch. She get them birds passed. I put her in first class and tell her to carry on a Dooney and Burke bag. She from Grape Street. She know how to work the mag and only buy white tees. Tell them to keep the purple tag, cause the laces in my chucks keep the beef cracking. I'll lay out like Chris khakis in that G-Wagon, lean like the 23's dragging. I got the whole NYC sagging.
Aftermath with an attitude, game time.
Another week, another legend. That's how I do. Focus, better known as a forerunner and pioneering voice in hip-hop culture since the late 90s. We talk about everything from his old label days, taking a step back away from music, his life, loves, family, and more. It's a 30-minute all-killer, no-filler tale, one of which I'm very honored to have had with him. And if you enjoy these type of stories, I would like to tell you that this podcast is available wherever it is you get podcasts, and I have a website that you can check out at bedroombeethovens.com. And most important, to keep the show relevant and into the right ears of as many people as possible, the best way to do this is to engage with the show. Take a second to like, comment, and subscribe. Not just to the YouTube, but just make sure you're tapped into the show so you get notified when the weekly episodes are available. Last but not least, if you're feeling extra supportive, join my people at patreon.com/bedroombeethovens. Every month you can give the pennies in your pocket in exchange for a few perks, and I can keep the show ad-free. And it feels good to have you guys at my disposal. We can chat, you can throw out guest suggestions, and much, much more. As we hit another set of tens, episode 170, here we go with the incomparable Focus. I mean, there might have been a time when you couldn't get magazines and hip-hop periodicals to cover your music or review your mixtapes, but I feel like the podcast era shows you a lot of love.
Yeah, and the funny thing about it is a lot of those magazines didn't know who I was. So that's the reason why I kind of did myself a disservice in using or utilizing anonymity, but now it's better than never.
Absolutely. And I also want to know how you're doing, because – you know, first impressions are a funny thing, you know, because, you know, if I check your Instagram, like you put a great emphasis on proverbs and wisdom and quotes and like any snippet that reinforces or promotes positivity. And society is so wired, maybe even including myself, where if we see those things, I think that the person posting them might be going through a rough time. Maybe they need reminders because something bad happened in their life. So I hope that's not the case with you over the last year or two during the pandemic.
Honestly, the last 2 years, 2.5 years have been the hardest of my life. But I think that a lot of people get lost in themselves so much that they forget that we need each other. And my first and only goal is to be as human as possible and treat others how I would like to be treated, you know? So I do the best I can to give as much positivity and bring people up, because for some reason, it helps me sleep better at night and it gives me purpose. So that's where, you know, everything that I do, it just lies in the fact that I feel like it's my purpose.
Yeah. And then coincidentally, earlier this year, Eric Sermon said that his mental health has been a factor for a while, and he credited you and Dr. Dre for changing that.
Oh, wow. I had no idea.
I'm always tripping when I hear about legends in the game say they have mental health problems, because I get caught up like, you know, oh, Focus Three Dots produced for the biggest names in music and mixed Grammy Award winning records. But then I forget it's a job. You know, you might be in the studio for 14 hours a day and it's a grind. And I'm assuming when Eric Sermon says that working with Dre and you improved his mental health, it's because the music industry is responsible maybe for his mental health dipping. Like, whatever makes you happy is the same stuff that makes you sad. So maybe it's a conversation more producers need to have.
And I think a lot of people forget that no matter what you do in life, you're still a human being, you know? So I'm going to have my ups and my downs, you know? And like I said, I just try my best not to focus on just myself. That's a blessing. I didn't know that Eric said that. That's really cool to hear.
Yeah, he posted that on Instagram. Yeah, and I think it might be a skill set that you learned. Like, not everyone maybe has the ability to be shrewd, you know, in order to keep your circle, to just involve people that are there for you and not what they can get out of you.
Yeah.
You know, when you reach a level of success, there has to be a lot of wolves in sheep clothing. So before they're able to take advantage of you, you know, how do you learn to identify those people and weed them out for your own mental health?
Well, it's just, like you said, being shrewd and discerning. It's very rare that I'm interlocked with somebody that I don't know deeper than the surface. You know, I pay attention to detail. I like to listen intently. And if we're of like minds, then it's very easy for us to lock in. But I don't like to waste anybody's time. And you can tell by opening up a dialogue with anybody. You could tell where their mind frame is and see if you're even going to lock in with that. I just don't waste time when it's not about life-giving things. If it just feels like we're sitting here and rambling on about nothing, it's not even worth the interaction.
Well, I got to make sure that I don't fall into that pitfall with you.
No, you know, it's all good.
So you're a junior, and the senior, you know, it's funny, you're regarded as like a West Coast legend, but your dad is truly a New York legend. And I'm talking about the Boys, the Big Apple Band, New York City, CHIC. You know, you got to have stories about musicians coming in and out of the house, crazy stories left and right. What is that like?
Honestly, my dad tried to keep his music life and his family life separate. We have had, Robert Palmer came over, Andy Taylor from Duran Duran came over. We've had some, you know, of course, Niall, because my dad and Niall were very close while he was alive. So, but as far as things were concerned, he loved his family life separate from his work life. And you can even find that on any interview that he talks about his family. Like, he likes to come home, or he used to like to come home and just be Bernard, or, you know, dad instead of Bernard from CHIC. So he never intermingled, if you will.
It's funny you say that, because there is this home video quality, grainy video of your father, and he's being interviewed, and they ask him if he would be okay with his kids entering the music scene. And surprisingly enough, he said that, you know, he would be proud, but he is not going to advocate or push you towards a career in music. And I'm sure he had his reasons. You know, it could have been the politics, or the long months away from your family, or the snakes in the grass, or maybe he wanted to spare that for you guys. But you knew at 6 years old that you wanted to be in the music industry. And when you turned 8, you knew you wanted to be a music producer. So for a guy who didn't want his son to enter the music industry, he's already losing momentum to a 6-year-old. You know, so did you guys grow up being combative in that sense, like butting heads? Did you really have to prove that this is what you wanted, or he knew early on that there was no convincing you?
Honestly, my dad was, that was when I was little, that was the height of his career. So there was no way for us to be combative. Pop was on the road most of the time. So when he came back home, we just wrapped ourselves around him because we didn't know how long he'd be gone the next time. But as I got older, you know, 16, 17, 18, around there, we definitely started bumping heads. And unfortunately, it really made it hard because I was doing it to honor him, and he was my idol, and I looked up to him, and I worshipped him, but then at the same time, I was doing it despite him. So it just made everything feel toiling, and it didn't have to, you know?
Do you remember the first beat you made where your dad, maybe his ears perked up, and didn't refer to that beat as cute?
It never happened. I made a song with my father. I think I was about 7 years old. I did a song called Tell About Love. I wrote the song, and my dad told me that one day I'm going to work with you. I'm going to play bass on one of your records. And I held him to it. I bugged him, and he woke up, and he played bass. I still have it on cassette, and my aunt sang the song for me. And it was probably one of the greatest days of my life, but it was still cute. And so my dad didn't really see anything that happened to me recently. He hasn't seen any of that, you know, so it was always just cute.
I read stuff like there was a quote of you saying that Dr. Dre has always been the only person who believed in me and has been a huge blessing to me and my family. How do you get to be on Dr. Dre's radar if nobody believed in you or took you serious? How are you able to be put in that position where he's the first person to really invest in you?
Well, I didn't say that he's the only one to believe in me, but he saw something in me that I didn't see in myself, and he pushed me. So I had some people that believed in me, and you know, Jason Weaver was the reason for me getting to Dr. Dre, because I was producing an artist that Jason had signed to him. So the artist's name was Dax, and his people had ends with Dre. So that's how that happened. But yeah, Dre was the first one and the only one that really, he saw something in me and he kept pushing me. And I was already, you know, when I was working with Jason Weaver, I was working around Red Zone and Tricky Stewart and Shakespeare and Kevin, you know, and Candy from Escape. And like, I was working around all these people, but there was no real push. Dre was like, you know, you're dope, but you can do better. You need to be working with better people, and you need to be doing this, and you need to be doing that. And he pushed me, and he never let up. He never, you know, took his hand off me. So I really appreciate him to this day for that.
But you never took the easy route, like, you know what, let me pick up the phone, let me call Nile Rodgers, let me talk with people that that worked with my father and try to get it in. You never took that route.
No. I think that the one, and there was a time where Nile had a label called Ear Candy, and it was him and Bud Tunick, and I had a group called BNPC, Black by Nature, Proud by Choice, and I wanted to be signed to the label because they were looking for new artists. And I didn't go there as Bernard Jr. I went there as BNPC. I went there as my group. And of course, it didn't work out, but the truth of the matter is I never wanted to go into the industry as an industry brat. I didn't want anybody thinking that the only reason why I got on it was because of my dad.
That's very admirable. And also, you know, I do remember that Nile Rodgers, you know, CHIC didn't release an album for 20 years. And your father, God rest his soul, passed away. But it was the first album to not have your father on there. Was that a hard record to visit when it came out?
I think if I can be transparent, I think anything that bears the name CHIC and not seeing him involved can be heart-wrenching. But that's what legacies do. You know, they build and they live forever. And I'm glad that Nile has put a new engine in that CHIC vehicle, and it's still running. You know, the people that are playing are fantastic. And, you know, Nile is very much the heart of CHIC still to this day. So, you know, I don't look at it like that so much anymore.
After producing some of the biggest hits in the world, I know you stepped away and you worked a regular day job, which is, I think, is incredible, and it's inspiring because that's like a Dave Chappelle move. You know, 99% of people either don't have the guts to do that and will continue to work unhappy and unfulfilled, but you know, you left, you know, what were the factors professionally and personally that contributed to the decision? And I want to preface this by saying, it was at UPS and your dad worked for the post office. So that can't be a coincidence. Even your day jobs outside of music were the same.
Wow. I didn't even think about that. I went into a place that felt very dark. I was drinking profusely. I was drinking heavily. And I just went into a very dark place. And spiritually, I felt numb. Emotionally, I felt bottomed out. So it just was affecting everything. And I think that when I stepped away and we, at the time I was married, and I took my family back to Atlanta, I didn't want, you know, at the time, I didn't want my wife thinking that I was just going to sit on the couch and wait for something to happen. So I wanted her to know that I'm not above working, whether it be manual work or whatever. I'm going to do whatever I have to do to take care of this family. And UPS was one. I did some construction work with a friend of mine, and all of this stuff was cool, but it wasn't bringing in the money that we needed for our family. So that's when I, you know, figured out that I needed to get back into the music thing.
So the records you produce are they're like one-time paychecks. Like there's no residuals. Like if you sell a beat to Beyonce, that's, you know, a G-Wagon, but it's not $30,000 a year for the rest of your life kind of thing.
And you know what? The thing about it is it could have been, and it should have been.
Yeah. Black skin, black faces, black people make black magic. So pay me every fucking dime and add taxes.
But a lot of my overhead at the time, I really wanted to be everything all at once. I wanted to be a label. I invested my own money into that, and I lost. I lost a lot of money behind that. I wanted my family to have the top of everything, the best of everything. And, you know, I can be honest enough to say that I was living outside of my means. You know, I was bringing in great money, but then it does get to the point where you're literally spending everything that's coming in, and you have to be more aware that saving is way, way more important than spending. And I was too busy trying to make sure that everybody was happy and taking care of, you know, a load of people. And, you know, it got me where I'm at. So now it's just kind of rebuilding, you know, and even now I'm not married anymore. You know, I still have my children, and my children are everything. So I'm still rebuilding to make sure that the legacy is everything that it needs to be for them.
Yeah. When we talk about legacy, the crazy thing is that if I take your music that you've produced just on streaming services, if I tally up all the songs you've produced, I bet it's like 500 million streams. It's got to be a massive number. But you, as an artist, listed on Spotify is less than 1,000.
Yeah.
Similar to your release before you signed Aftermath, you had this record with Busta Rhymes and this guy and this guy, and you did all that just based on the relationships that you fostered. But now, like, what if you were like, look, I'm going to release a DJ Khaled album. It's a Focus 3 Dot album. Not only am I going to reach out to my homies, but I'm going to pick up the phone and call in all the favors over the past 20 years. Beyonce, Kendrick, M, Dre, Slum Village, 50 Cent, all the producers that I know, Diamond D, Mustard, Q-Tip, Montel Jordan, and like just, you know, is that something that kind of enters the brain at any point?
It always does. And I think that the thing that has always kept me at bay is that now those favors have a dollar amount attached to them. And no matter what, this is our job. This is like you said, it's a job. It's my passion, don't get me wrong, but it's my job. This is how I pay my bills. This is how I feed my kids. And all of those people that you mentioned have kids. So who am I to say, let's do this for free? And we know that we're not getting the residuals that we used to, because streaming is giving us penny dust, you know? So now it's not so, I'm not apropos to turn around and tally up all of my relationships and tell them, man, if we make this record, we can get this this look and maybe and possibly. And so I'm not going to do that. If I do it, I would love to be backed by a label and make sure that everybody gets money, because that's the bottom line, unfortunately, in this industry.
Yeah. And then you mentioned Tricky Stewart. And, you know, what's interesting is, you know, 23 years ago, you produced for Soleil on the Skin Deep album, and you worked with Tricky Stewart. It was, according to Wikipedia, it's both of you guys' start, but I know it's not. But it's like the first studio album that you're both credited with. And in 23 years, you guys went on your own paths. You work with different artists. You encounter different things. And when I lay your resume and his resume on the table, coincidentally, you're both 5-time Grammy winners.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. That's cool.
Yeah. And you go from that album, and 4 years later, he's producing for Madonna, and he produced Umbrella for Rihanna. And you went in 4 years to Beyonce and The Game. And I can't think of any two music producers who rose that quick in 4 years.
But I did feel a kindred spirit when around the Stewarts, Tricky, Mark, and his brother Laney. I really just, on a creative level, we always had amazing conversations. And it was really an honor to work in that building. That's literally Jason Weaver's. That's his cousins. So it was kind of a family affair type of ordeal. So it was really, really dope. Like I take that back. It wasn't an ordeal. It really was an amazing experience.
Is this is the same Jason Weaver that was on Chingy's One Call Away, right?
Yeah. Jason Weaver, smart guy, the actor. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
That was my partner and my homie. So when I met him through Omar Gooding, and they were doing Smart Guy, and they brought me into the fold, and I did a couple of tracks for the actual show. And Weave was telling me that he was building a production company in Atlanta, and he gave me an opportunity, and I came out there.
So you had overlap with Marilyn Haywood too?
Yes.
And they all treated you well?
Yeah.
Awesome. So when you're fostering a career like Dax, you know, I'm on the outside looking in, so I don't know him personally, but it looks like he hasn't put out much since the Wash soundtrack. When you have someone who doesn't take off like that, is it the work ethic? Did he not work as hard as you? Did something, you know, did life happen and he had to step out of music? You know, what kind of happens there?
I think that life happened. Unfortunately, I don't remember verbatim what happened, but I do know that after we did the Wash soundtrack, Dre was still looking for new talent. And I don't think that there was a deal put on the table for Dax at that moment, you know? So I don't really remember why we didn't work anymore after that. But, you know, I think that I kind of got tunnel vision, excuse me. And when Dre said, you know, let's get to work, I got to work. I just started making tracks. So it could be just a, like you said, a bunch of life just happening all at once.
And that the era of you being on Scotty Brothers, that came and went by this time, right?
Yeah, that was before.
Because, you know, that seems like a label with an identity crisis, because out of 100 releases, they maybe had 3 or 4 hip-hop records. You know, they have James Brown, Weird Al Yankovic, and DJ Yella. And I know nothing frustrates you more than saying, oh, well, you know, Focus is just a hip-hop producer. But I imagine back then, if you said, hey, I want to work with Weird Al, they probably would have said no. They're going to attach a genre to you, and then you kind of have to stay in that lane.
Yeah. They only saw me as a rapper. That's why I was on Street Life. I wasn't really on Scotty Brothers. I was on Street Life through Scotty Brothers. It was distributed through Scotty Brothers. But they, you know, they saw me as a rapper.
So why was Dr. Dre so against releasing R&B under Aftermath? Because correct me if I'm wrong, but Truth Hurts was like the first and last R&B artist on Aftermath. Was that a record acting like a barometer, like a gauge of success to see how R&B would do on that label?
I think that Dre wasn't against putting out R&B. He knows what he's great at. And when it comes down to R&B, if you look at his history in it, he jumps in and jumps out. It was like the first real R&B album that we did was Truth Hurts. You know, and prior to that, he had artists that were signed that were R&B artists like RC and different kids that were on the Aftermath Entertainment compilation that he first put out. So he had it. He had people that were doing R&B. But I think it's more of a love-hate relationship with something that felt like it was dying at the moment. R&B felt like it was just taking a turn and it wasn't really keeping its true integrity. And so Dre was like, man, let's just go hard on this hip-hop thing, because that's not, it's never changed on him. It never changed to the point where he didn't know how to exist.
It's funny because like a year or two later, you have that hit with 112. You know, so he has someone on the roster that, you know, proven could make R&B hits, but still, it's funny that nothing came from that.
Yeah.
Even on the hip-hop side, I think, and this is just my theory, I think the frustration level would have been way lower if Detox was never announced. I feel like announcing a new project early, even releasing, you know what? I remember there was a Dr. Pepper commercial that had like a new Dre beat and everybody went crazy for. We were given the public crumbs and music just never came out year after year. And, you know, you had to take some time for yourself. And in retrospect, it probably would have been better to just work on the project and never have told the world that it was coming, because then pressures mount.
Everything you just said was literally gospel. No, literally. Like the biggest headache was running up against obstacles that we didn't see coming. And it was just the fact that it was announced and everybody was just waiting for it. And when you have the entire world trying to knock down your one front door, people don't want to just walk up to that door and open it up. They'd rather just recess into the house and figure things out. And I don't know how many times we went through different segments of what Detox was going to sound like, and beats and songs and leaks. And it was just so many things that felt like it was against the project instead of being for the project. So I can understand why he was frustrated as well.
Well, I learned just, you know, he was hospitalized last year to a brain aneurysm. We all know that. But I just learned that the doctors thought that he was going to die. They actually invited his family to the hospital so they could give their last respects to him. But he beat the odds. I wonder if now he's in this mind frame of, oh, you know what? Life is short. Let me start pumping out projects, maybe. I don't know. Did you have a clue that he was so close to death at the time?
No, I didn't. The way that I found out, I actually heard from a cat that works with us, and then I called his phone. And oddly enough, he answered the phone, and he sounded tired. But he was like, yeah, I'm in a hospital. He was like, yeah, I had a brain aneurysm. I'm going to give you a call back, and hung up the phone. And I freaked out. Now, by this time, you know, my son had passed away. My wife had left. And then hearing this, it was just, I lost it. I'm like, yo, this is like my big brother. But I heard it from his voice, but still I felt like I almost lost my big bro. And all of us, we all felt like that. We look at Dre like our big bro. So it was really a surreal moment. But then for him to get out of the hospital and go right to the studio, I'm like, I have no reason to ever say that I can't do something. Like, he is the biggest picture of strength for me to look at every day. And I'm just like, man, I have to have that kind of drive.
Yeah, your perspective, a decade ago, you said that your family's getting bigger and I have to remain relevant and to keep food on the table and clothes on my kid's back. 10 years later, is your mindset the same or has your outlook kind of changed?
No, not even a little bit. Like, the only reason why I get up in the morning is because of my children. The only reason why I get up in the morning is to make sure that they understand that dad is going to do the best he can for them. And especially now, you know, the world is a crazy, crazy place. And I really want them to be able to be secure the best to my ability, you know? So yeah, it's still the same.
For who I am, but what I got, but she loves me. She loves me not, she loves me. She loves me not.
We've covered a lot, and from the beginning to now, and you know what, aside from the great Diamond D Rearview project that you contributed on, I do want to give you the floor to kind of tell people what they can expect from you this year, maybe even next. What's cooking?
I appreciate the compliment, and I appreciate this interview. It was really dope. When it comes down to it, we're just always working on music, so just keep a lookout for the camp, Aftermath. We're going to have some good surprises coming soon. I know that Dre announced a Marsha Ambrosius album earlier this year, and we've been really getting that together. So I'm excited for my sister and her endeavor. We've just been in the studio making music. As far as me personally, I have two more offerings that I'm going to give my listeners, the analog and the digital world. I'm going to do 9 and 10 before the year is out. And then if you go from 1 to 10, you have 100 beats that I put out, you know, and it's very important, I think, that I just keep giving the people music, because that's where my whole purpose is. So just keep looking out. I don't have anything slated, but I know that sometimes I just get up and just put things out. So just keep up with me.
Yeah, I heard a track by you called You Ain't Fresh. And head to head, if I compare that with music that came out this year, it's still one of my favorite tracks. And it's still a great track. And when you released it, you didn't think anybody would like the song. That's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the funny thing about it is a lot of my artistry stuff hits the wall and it slides down, but I still make it out of love. And I mean, I appreciate that, because that's crazy that you even brought that song up. But yeah, I'm going to keep doing it.
I love it, man. And it's almost like it's you like showing love to the hip hop community without burning bridges. You know, you said something once that I will remember for the rest of my life. You said one clown is a show, two or more clowns is a circus. And you know, I look at the game, you know, he's putting on a show for publicity. You know, why is a veteran in the game going to promote an album with a 10-minute diss track towards an artist? You know, it's I feel like someone like you don't have to do that, you know?
No, and I would never do that. I don't need, and however it works for Game and other artists that have done this is how it works. I'm not going to speak on their process, but I don't need to be condescending or bring somebody down to build me up. If people want to come and see me, I'm here. I would rather look eye to eye with my listeners. I make myself very tangible. And I believe that that's where the connection lies. So yeah, I'm not a fan of that at all, but unfortunately it is part of, hip-hop and how it was created, you know, battling and stuff like that. So.
It's unfortunate, but Focus, again, it was an honor and a pleasure. Thank you so much for swinging by.
Oh, honor's mine. Thank you so much.